good to see you again. All right. Before we start, actually, two more quick announcements. We do have a discovery class right after worship today, 11:15. So anyone who wants to know a little bit more about our church, we'll have a discovery class right in there. And then also baptism is going to be during Easter Sunday. So anyone who is not baptized but would like to get baptized, come see me after church. And we'll have a baptism class next week. So I'll give you the details of that a little bit later. But now we're going to again dig into the book of Philippians. This is a wonderful book, as you know. It's about joy. Apostle Paul has written to the people of Philippi, and he was in prison while he wrote this epistle. And the thing about this epistle is that he started out in prison. You know, he was, the book of Acts tells us that Apostle Paul started this ministry in Philippi some 10 plus years before he wrote this letter to the Philippians. And so he was in the Philippian jail, remember, and he ministered to the jailer and his family. So that's the little bit of a history of this book and Paul's history with the people at Philippi. It's just kind of ironic that he did his ministry when he planted the church in Philippi. He was in jail, and he was in jail because he was preaching the gospel. And then now that he is in jail, he's sharing his heart to the people of Philippi. And we're going to see a couple individuals today who I think we should possibly look at for modeling. Of course, so this book is about joy. And last couple weeks we talked about Jesus Christ. In chapter 2, the first 11 verses talked about the humility that Christians should have, and ultimately that example was given by Jesus, who gave his life for us, right? So that he was the ultimate example of humility. And Paul continues with that as we, the believers, the people of Philippi, needed to know how to live the Christian life. Paul says, hey, follow Christ, because this is how you ought to live as followers of Christ. A Christian means little Christ. And so follow Christ in his humility, and do not grumble, or do not complain, as we talked about last week. And this week we're going to see he gives two individuals, two examples of individuals who also follow Christ, and they are Timothy and Epaphroditus. So with that, let's go ahead and read verses 17 through 30 of Philippians chapter 2. But even if I am being poured out as a drink offering upon the sacrifice and service of your faith, I rejoice and share my joy with you all. You too, I urge you, rejoice in the same way and share your joy with me. But I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you shortly, so that also may be encouraged when I learn of your condition. For I have no one else of kindred spirit who will genuinely be concerned for your welfare. For they all seek after their own interests, not those of Christ Jesus. But you know of his proven worth, that he served with me in the furtherance of the gospel, like a child serving his father. Therefore, I hope to send him immediately, as soon as I see how things go with me. And I trust in the Lord that I myself also will be coming shortly. But I thought it necessary to send to you, Epaphroditus, my brother and fellow worker and fellow soldier, who is also your messenger and minister to my need, because he was longing for you all and was distressed because you had heard that he was sick. For indeed he was sick to the point of death, but God had mercy on him, and not on him only, but also on me, so that I would not have sorrow upon sorrow. Therefore, I have sent him all the more eagerly, so that when you see him again, you may rejoice, and I may be less concerned about you. Receive him then in the Lord with all joy, and hold men like him in high regard, because he came close to death for the work of Christ, risking his life to complete what was deficient in your service to me. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord Jesus, thank you for the reading of your word. Thank you for your written word. Lord Jesus, you are the living word, and we come before you and ask that you would bless us as we study your word today. So minister to us, and in your precious name we pray, amen. Amen. So, Apostle Paul, as you know, he is in jail, and so at this point, he is not sure if he's going to be released. But what is sure is that Timothy is with him, and Timothy is actually ministering to him. And he says to the people of Philippi, hey, I'm going to send Timothy to you soon, but right now I need him. He's going to stay with me for a bit. But I'm going to send Epaphroditus, who you sent to me to encourage me, and I'm going to send him back to you. So that's the big picture. Now, what I want to do is I want to look at these two individuals today in the text of Scripture. We see Timothy and how he played a part, and how Paul calls Timothy one who is of a kindred spirit, someone of the same mindset, someone of the same attitude. That's what Paul means here by kindred spirit in verse 20. And then we'll see who Epaphroditus was. Well, Timothy, a little bit about his background. Timothy, if you look at chapter 16 of Acts, you see that Timothy had a mother named Eunice, actually, and the book of Timothy, 2 Timothy, talks about Timothy's grandmother, Lois. So Timothy's grandmother, Lois, and mother, Eunice, were instrumental in Timothy's faith. His father was Greek, based on chapter 16 of Acts, and it seemed like his father was nowhere in sight. The Bible just does not talk about his father other than that he was Greek. But his mother was Jewish, and grandmother Lois was Jewish, and so he was raised by a Jewish mother, possibly a single parent raising. So Timothy was most likely raised by a single parent, his mother. And this is why in some ways where Paul and Timothy might have gotten along so well, Timothy as a young believer who grew up in the Word of God because of the faithfulness of his mom. And he then came across Paul. If we look at Acts 16, let me just read these few verses to you. It's amazing how the Bible connects in so many different ways. Paul came also to Derbe and to Lystra, and a disciple was there named Timothy, the son of a Jewish woman who was a believer, but his father was a Greek, and he was well spoken of by the brethren. The pronoun goes back to actually Timothy. Timothy was well spoken of by the brethren who were in Lystra and Iconium. Paul wanted this man to go with him, and he took him. So who's he referring to? Timothy. Paul saw how Timothy was. And so Paul, this is where we see how they connected here. And so then the text continues to say, he took Timothy and he took him and circumcised him because because of the Jews who were in those parts, and they all knew that his father was a Greek. And so here we see the beginning of their relationship, and we see in our text of Philippians that Paul calls Timothy his spiritual son. And so Timothy probably did not have a father as he grew, it seems like. And so he needed a mentor. And Paul saw that this young man was a godly man, and so Paul took upon this man to mentor. And so why is Paul bringing in Timothy in light of his picture of being humble before God, as he's sharing with the Philippian believers to be humble? Well, Paul is saying, hey, Timothy is one of those individuals who was humble before God, because look, as I was taking him, he could have resisted me. He could have said, no, I don't need a mentor. You know, sometimes our pride gets in the way where we don't want people to teach us. Timothy was not so. He was humble to learn under a mentor. And so I wanted to share Timothy a little bit, and Paul wanted to share Timothy to the Philippian believers, because, you know, men and women, we all need mentors. And, you know, most of you here may or may not have mentors, but you, if you don't, that's those of you who are young in your faith, those who are relatively young in your age, you should be seeking somebody who can mentor you, who can help you to grow spiritually, who can be accountable to you, who can challenge you, and who can tell you as it is. You know, the Bible says flattery doesn't go anywhere. At least my translation. But, you know, somebody who tells you as it is, you may not want to hear it right away, but you appreciate it later. Book of Proverbs. I mean, it tells you that it's better to hear the truth in love than to hear flattering words which are not necessarily true. We all want our ears tickled. We'd rather hear flattery than the truth. But you know, that mentor that you trust will be the one who will stretch you, who will challenge you, who will help you to grow in him. And Timothy needed a mentor. And you know, when Paul chose Timothy, Timothy did not resist from what we can see. He accepted Paul as a mentor. What a mentor Timothy had. And Paul says this of Timothy, "For I have no one else of kindred spirit, no one else of same mindedness, who will genuinely be concerned for your welfare." So as Paul is in jail, and he's, you know, suffering the consequences of being in jail, not because something evil that he's done, but because something good. He shared the gospel. He shared the gospel, and he was put in jail for that. Today, as you know, in the Middle East and some other areas, in China and other places, people who share the gospel are locked up. So it's no different today. The gospel changes lives. And Paul knew that Timothy had the same kindred spirit, same mindset to share the gospel. And you know what? He had concern for the Philippian believers. Paul did, and so did Timothy. And that's why Paul said, "I want to send Timothy to you because he's got that same spirit that I have for you." And Paul says, "No one else is as concerned for you, your welfare, as Timothy. So that's why I want to send him. But right now, I need him. I'm not going to send him right now, but I need him. I'm going to send him." Verse 21, "For they all seek after their own interests." This is others. And you know what? There may be believers who are not always seeking God, not always seeking for the welfare of others, but seeking for their own interests. I wonder if any one of us fall under this category, or the category under Timothy, where we're caring for others. Verse 22, "But you know of his proven worth," referring to Timothy, because when Paul started the ministry in Philippi 10 plus years ago, Timothy was with him. "And he served with me in the furtherance of the gospel like a child serving his father." Notice the imagery here, and notice the relationship that Paul puts Timothy with him, like a child serving his father. Paul was a mentor to this young man. And again, if you do not have a mentor, I encourage you to seek a mentor. Pray for someone. Pray that God will send you a mentor so that you can grow in Him. We all need mentors. And maybe some of you are mature in your spiritual walk. And maybe you are in a position where you can mentor somebody. Pray that God will send you to mentor somebody. So everyone here can either be mentored or mentor. Therefore, I hope to send him immediately, soon as I see how things go with me. And I trust in the Lord that I myself also be coming to you shortly. So again, he wants to be there, but he's not sure because he is in jail. He's waiting for the verdict. But this Timothy was like a child to Paul and someone of a kindred spirit. You know how precious that is? Someone who you can trust, who you know have the same or similar goals, similar passions, similar values. How awesome it is for you and me to have someone precious like that. Jonathan and David were such individuals. If you look at the 1 Samuel and you study 1 Samuel and you look at the life of Jonathan and you look at the life of David, you can't help but to see, the Bible says, Jonathan's soul was knitted together with David's soul in 1 Samuel 18. How awesome is that? These two godly men, these two people who love God, who had courage to stand up for God, who were very bold, who were faithful, who took steps of faith to honor God. These guys, their hearts were knitted together. Why? Because they had kindred spirit. 1 Samuel 14, you see Jonathan, you see him in action. You see this guy, you know, the Philistine, the Israelites were fighting the Philistines. And, you know, for some reason the Philistines had a little bit of advantage because they had the tools, they had the iron, they had the swords and all of that. The Israelites were shortage of that. The scene in 1 Samuel 14 talks about how Jonathan and his armor bearer was with him, and Jonathan says, hey, you know, let's go and see what God can do for us as we possibly go attack these Philistines. And so Jonathan takes the initiative in faith. There are these Philistines on this hill, and Jonathan says, hey, if the Lord is with us, if he's with us, we will have victory. And so it's not the condition if, it's, I mean, yes, if it's used, but Jonathan acted in faith. He knew that God was with his people. And what he was saying there, I believe, was that, hey, he wants to go in faith, and he doesn't want to presume, but if God is helping him or putting this on his heart, then God will give him a confirmation. So he says this, hey, if the Philistine says, hey, come up here, then we'll go up. You know, this will be, there's this garrison, there's these Philistines on this hill. And so Jonathan and his armor bearer said, Jonathan says, hey, if they say come up, we'll go up. If they say, hey, we'll come down, then we'll wait till they come down and we'll fight them. So just as he says that, the Philistines see these two Hebrews and they say, oh, look, the Hebrews came out of their holes. And so they said, well, you guys come up here. And Jonathan says, that's our cue. God has given them to us. So Jonathan says to his armor bearer, hey, follow me. So Jonathan is climbing up this hill with his hands and feet. He's climbing up, and he's in a vulnerable position because he's in a position of weakness. These guys are up here, and he's going up. Anybody in the military would know that the higher the position is more strategic and more strength that you have. Well, anyway, Jonathan knew that God was going to deliver them to him, to his people. And so he rushes up there. He doesn't hesitate. As soon as he gets that confirmation, he runs up there. And his armor bearer is coming up with him. And then the Bible says, he defeated, those two guys defeated 20 Philistines. Two guys. So 1-to-10 ratio. Two guys defeated 20 people in a hand-to-hand combat. And you know what the Bible says? All the Philistines became trembling. They were afraid as a result of what these two guys did. And then you look a couple pages later, chapter 17. David comes into the picture. You know where he comes into the picture? The story that you guys know so well. David and Goliath. You know, the Philistines and the Israelites are in a battle array. The Philistines have a champion named Goliath. Day in and day out for 40 days. In the morning and then in the evening, the Bible says, this Goliath was challenging the people of Israel. Saying, hey, you pick a champion from your team, and I'm the champion from my team. Let's be economical about this battle. You know, two of us fight, whoever wins, wins the battle, wins the war. That's it. And so this Goliath was challenging the Israelites for 40 days, morning and evening. So 80 times they heard this challenge. No one went to this challenge, except David, the shepherd boy. His dad sends him to see the welfare of his three brothers who are in the army. David has some cheese and some food to give to his brothers. And then David, as he's delivering this food to his brothers, he hears the challenge. And he says, what will be done to this man, to this uncircumcised Philistine who taunts the armies of the living God? Well, the Israelites and the armies, the well-seasoned people, are afraid day in and day out. David is upset that this guy is taunting the living God. And so David then runs and goes after Goliath and defeats him. So you have Jonathan, who's trusting God, who loves God, who, you know, acts in light of what God has told him to do in his heart. David, who also loves God. David, who sees God as being mocked. He can't stand for that. So he goes after this Goliath. You know how tall Goliath was? He was just, his head would be just under, short of the basketball rim, just to show you how tall he was. David was probably like 5'7", my height, almost perfect. So, it's like, that's the difference of height. Goliath's spear weighed 125 pounds. Some of us can't even lift 25 pounds barely. 125 pounds is a javelin. So just to give you an example, but David didn't look at that. David looked at this individual as someone who was taunting his God. You can see why these two guys had kindred spirits. Jonathan and David, they were similar in their love for God, in their passion for God, in their defense for God. And that's why the Bible said Jonathan's soul and David's soul were knitted together, like-minded people. Paul and Timothy weren't like that in ministry. Do you have a kindred spirit in the ministry that God's given you? Do you have a mentor? Are you a mentor? Do you have someone who has the same spirit as you do, that love for God, that passion for God, that passion for His Word? That's what Paul is talking about here when he talks about a kindred spirit. And then he says this about another individual, Epaphroditus. Let me tell you a little bit about Epaphroditus. That's it. That's all I know about Epaphroditus. No one, hardly anybody knows anything about him. What's here, other than what's probably here, he was an individual that hardly anybody knew. But he, and you know, for us, he was probably just an ordinary individual. But in the eyes of Paul, in the eyes of God, he was no ordinary individual. You know why? because this man was faithful. This man was faithful despite the fact that he almost died being faithful. He was faithful. So it's better to seek faithfulness than to seek fame, because he was a nobody in the eyes of the world. He was a nobody pretty much in the eyes of the church. But he was somebody before Paul. He was somebody before God. Let me tell you why. Because this brother, as Paul defines him, a believer, this brother, a fellow worker and a fellow soldier, who is also your messenger. So the people of Philippi sent this person, Epaphroditus, to Paul, and for the purpose of encouraging Paul. And I believe he had some gifts from the people at Philippi to give to Paul. You know how far Philippi and Rome was? About somewhere between 700 to 800 miles. So it would be, if it was 700, it would be here to Jacksonville, Florida. 800 here to Daytona Beach, Florida. So think about it. Back then, when they traveled by either walking or by horse, Epaphroditus had to travel at least about 700 miles one way to get to Paul, to deliver this gift, deliver some encouragement to Paul. And you know what? And that would have taken days, maybe weeks. And Epaphroditus probably had to work somewhere, so he took a leave of absence. So that meant possibly he lost money to do that. He took time off from work to go to minister to Paul, to carry this message to Paul from the church, from Ephesus. And on his way, he got sick somehow. So sick that he almost died. The Bible says that God had mercy on him. On his way, I'm not sure how far on his way, it doesn't say, he got sick. He could have turned around. He said, well, I can't go any further because I'm so sick. I don't think I can make it. Let me at least possibly die near my hometown or my home. But he didn't do that. He tracked on. That's why he was faithful. That's what faithfulness means. Being able to finish what you commit to do. And so that's why I believe God had mercy on him. And that's why I believe Paul is elevating this man. None of us really know a whole lot about Epaphroditus. But what we do know is he was faithful. And that's a quality that God wants us to have. And if you look out throughout the pages of Scripture, you see that God takes care of those who are faithful. God blesses the faithful. It's not the degrees. It's not the status. It's not those who have money. It's not necessarily, I mean, not to say that those who have degrees, money, and all that are not faithful. I'm saying one of the key qualities that God looks at is faithfulness. How faithful are you? How faithful am I to God and what He has asked us to do? Whatever that may be. You know, we spoke with Bill earlier. If you don't mind, Bill, I want to just highlight your faithfulness for all these years. For 8 years, day in and every Sunday, you've been just faithfully doing the media and also you faithfully teach. And you've been faithful in attending, you know, Bible studies, you've been teaching, you know, and that's huge. A huge pillar to the church. Many of you are also in that position. Many of you are teaching faithfully to the elementary, to the middle school, to the high school students. No one else may know, but God knows. No one else may notice, God knows. And those kids who see you week after week. If you're not there, they notice. Faithfulness is what God wants you to have. Being faithful to Him in your walk with Him day in and day out. None of us are perfect. I will be the first one to admit that I'm perfect. And others will be the first one to tell me that I'm not perfect. And I agree with that. I am not perfect. None of us are perfect. That's why we need God day in and day out. We need to faithfully seek Him because we need Him daily. So in your quiet times, in your reading of Scripture, in your prayers, attending church, attending Bible study, are you faithful in these areas? God wants us to be faithful. Epaphroditus was faithful. And because of his faithfulness, he encouraged this big person that we know, Apostle Paul. Who does not know of Apostle Paul? Right? Paul was impressed by this individual. Because of his faithfulness, not because of his fame. And so Paul says, hey, he ministered to me. I want to send him back to you. I want to send him back to you as quickly as I can. And then he says this of Epaphroditus in verse 29. You can see the mind and heart and the thought of Apostle Paul of Epaphroditus. He says, receive him then in the Lord with all joy, and hold men like him in high regard. So Paul says, individuals like Epaphroditus who are faithful, hold these individuals in high regard. It's not the ones that necessarily have status, prestige, titles, all of those people. And maybe they deserve it. So I don't want to take anything away from those who deserve that. But Paul is saying, hey, you and I know, some people have titles but no substance and no faithfulness. Here is an individual with no title but substance, but has faithfulness as a tremendous quality. We all have life that we live. We all have pressures in life, due dates. We all have sleep deprivation sometimes. Sometimes it's our own choosing. But we all have life that we deal with. But the thing is, in light of that hardship, are we faithful? That's the key. And that's what God wants us to have, is that faithfulness like Epaphroditus. And that's why Paul says, hold men like him in high regard. Why? Because he came close to death for the work of Christ, risking his life to complete what was deficient, in your service to me. So, which one of us are like Timothy? Which one of us are like Paul? Which one of us are like Epaphroditus? Which one of us are like John? Which one of us are like David? Ultimately, we should all be like Jesus Christ. As Christians, followers of Christ, little Christ, are we exemplifying Christ? And many of us, maybe the Pauls, the Timothys, the Jonathans, the Davids, the Epaphroditus, but we all need to be someone like them, someone who loves God with a passion. Someone who will defend God with a passion. Someone who will be faithful. Someone who is humble like Timothy to learn under somebody. Someone who is knowledgeable like Paul to teach someone. So let's pray that we would be like one of these individuals. What say you? Let's go to him in prayer. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much. Thank you so much for your example of humility. Thank you so much that you left all the glories of heaven to come to us, to be an example, not only be an example, but to die for us so that we can have life and that we can follow you. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your sacrificial love. For greater love has no one than this, that one lay down his life for his friends. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the lesson today. Help some of us to be like the Pauls, the Timothys, the Epaphroditus, the Jonathans, the Davids, Lord. Help us to ultimately follow you so that we can encourage others as we live life for you. So we commit our lives before you, Lord, and ask for your help. In your precious name, Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen.